So this is a residential area of a suburban town in Massachusetts, and if you look on my right, you will actually see that there are nicely paved sidewalks. But we know from what we just talked about for the built environment and walkability, access and availability of sidewalks isn't the only thing that determines walkability. Other factors that influence walkability include mixed land use and proximity to common destinations, such as grocery stores and banks. And so for here, while there are sidewalks available, it is primarily residential, and so there are no other places that you can get to via walking in terms of common destinations. So thinking back to what we talked about in terms of street connectivity, I'm about to pull into a cul-de-sac, which is essentially a dead-end street. Again, there are sidewalks available, but you'll see that very few people are actually walking around. And there's only one main road in order to get from various houses to other places. So it would be a lot faster to drive to one house on this particular loop than walking from one house to another. So here you see is where the loop occurs, and it's essentially a dead end road. All right, now we're headed back to the main road. So here we are headed into a large shopping center, and this is actually pretty typical of a lot of places in the United States, particularly in suburban or rural areas. There are lots of different restaurants and stores around, including grocery stores, banks, clothing stores. You can see that the parking lots are actually incredibly expansive, so the stores line the perimeter, but in terms of the parking spaces available, there's no shortage of parking around here. And even though all of the different stores are pretty walkable, you can walk from, for example, the grocery store to a pet store or a sandwich stop across the street. Nobody is walking around. Everybody is driving. So somewhere in the shopping center are all the people who came in these cars, but we actually don't see them at all, except going to and from their cars. In this area, you'll see that the street planning and urban design is actually much more friendly to walkers and bikers than it is for drivers, as evidenced by the multiple crosswalks and the ample sidewalk space for pedestrians and for bikers. So when we think about walkability, we usually think about how conducive an area is to walking, but biking is another way in which we can be physically active and still get from place to place. On the left here, we have some Hubway bikes, which you can rent for about $6 for a 24-hour period. Behind me, you can see that there's mixed land use, a mix of commercial shops for the most part, but there are also apartment buildings that are located behind the shops. So this is an area where you can see that there's a good quality of land mixed use, both residential and commercial. Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the tour. You've seen different characteristics of the built environment and the food environment in different areas in Massachusetts, but you might also be wondering, what are some of the other characteristics of neighborhoods around the US and around the world? For this online activity, you can explore two different websites to get a sense of how different neighborhoods are within the US as well as in other countries. The first website is walkscore.com. Walkscore.com provides an index of walkability ranging from 0 to 100, 100 being the highest. They provide this information using online and iOS services. The second website that you can visit is the US Department of Agriculture Food Environment Atlas. This particular website provides a map of the US, and although you can't enter in addresses, you can click on different areas on the map to get a sense about differences between neighborhoods in access and proximity of grocery stores.
The USDA Food Environment Atlas also provides information about food deserts in particular areas in the United States.